Christmas time as a child was a wonderful time, a time of anticipation and hope. You know, the sights and the sounds with the decorations and the music and the special foods and the special cookies and Santa Claus and all those things were wonderful. The best part about Christmas as a child was the anticipation of Christmas morning. When you'd run down the stairs as fast as you can and you look under the tree and you'd see all those presents that Santa had brought you or that your mom and dad had gotten for you. It was just an unbelievable moment in the year, every year. And the truth of the matter is that what made Christmas so special as a child was those months of buildup. Those months where you'd be searching your mom and dad's closet or under their bed, searching throughout the house trying to find out what the gift was that you had received. When that moment finally came where you were able to open the gift and see what it was, you were filled with joy because the gift was greater than you could have ever imagined. But the thing I find most interesting, at least in my life, was that within an hour, maybe two, of receiving that gift, the excitement was gone. Now sure, I was still happy that I had gotten the gift. I was still thankful that I had gotten the gift, and the gift was certainly still mine. It was not taken away from me. But the joy and excitement was taken away because once I played with it, I took it for granted. It became stale, even after only an hour or two. I think sometimes that's the way it is for us as Christians as well when it comes to our relationship with God, the Holy Spirit, the third person of the Trinity. I think a lot of times we know we have the gift of the Spirit living in us. We know it's ours. It hasn't been taken away. We know it's something good. It's something that we enjoy, but sometimes it's something we take for granted, something that becomes stale in our lives. And when that happens, it can become easy to wonder why God is not as close to us as we would like. See, we begin to think that even though we have the gift, we have to do something special for God. We begin to think that the Holy Spirit will be there when I need Him, but right now I don't need the Holy Spirit, so it's not a big deal. And our faith can begin to feel stale. Even though it's real, it's still there, it's still ours, and we still love God. We know God still loves us. Begin to feel stale. I think that happens because we stop anticipating the Holy Spirit can actually work through us and in us. Tonight is the first night that we're having for our small groups this year, King of Glory. And through the months, through the fall months, we're going to be looking at lessons from Acts and see what the early church can teach us about how we can live our lives as Christians today. The first lesson we can learn from the early church is the idea that the Holy Spirit is alive and well and active, and we just need to begin anticipating. Once again, He can work and will work through us as His children. Now, it's interesting, the disciples were anticipating the gift of the Spirit on that first Pentecost Sunday. They had not received it yet. You see, before this time, they'd been walking with God Himself in Jesus Christ, the second person of the Trinity. They'd been walking with God on earth. He'd been teaching them. He'd been instructing them. He'd been feeding them. He'd been with them. But after Jesus died and ascended into heaven, He was no longer physically present with them. But Jesus had promised that He was going to send His Spirit to them. He promised in John, whenever He was about to be crucified, that He would send a comforter and a counselor to the disciples. In Acts, after the disciples see Jesus ascend into heaven, an angel appears to them and says, "Go back and wait for the promised Holy Spirit." And so that's where the disciples are. They're in an upper room in Jerusalem, waiting for the gift of the Spirit, anticipating with great excitement what God is going to do in their lives. And what happens on that Pentecost Sunday is more than they could have ever imagined, is greater than they could have ever hoped for. We read in Acts chapter 2, "When the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each one of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in either tongues and other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And at this sound the multitude came together, and they were bewildered because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us in his own native language? Parthians and Medes and Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea and Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians. We hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God. And all were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, What does this mean? The disciples had been anticipating the Spirit, and when the Spirit came, that mighty rush of wind and the tongues of fire, their lives were changed. The gift was greater than they could have ever imagined. Before the Holy Spirit came, they were timid and fearful. And as soon as the Holy Spirit filled them, they became brave and courageous, so much so that they were willing to go out into the town of Jerusalem and tell everyone about Jesus, that he'd been killed, but that he'd risen from the dead for them. They'd been uneducated men and women who, when the Holy Spirit came upon them, began to speak the very words of God. They were believers in God. Believers in Jesus, but they still sometimes lack the certainty of the hope that they had in Christ. When the Holy Spirit entered into them, all uncertainty is taken away, and they're left with no doubt that Jesus is going to come back for them. Their lives were transformed in such a way that it was noticeable to the rest of the community. Their lives were transformed in such a way that other people were affected and came to faith. If we keep on reading the book of Acts chapter 2, we see that Peter proclaimed a gospel message and thousands came to faith that day. But the thing that's amazing about this gift of the Holy Spirit the disciples received at Pentecost is that it was not a one-time event. You see, when the Holy Spirit came into their life, it was there. The Spirit was there for the rest of their life. And the Spirit continued to strengthen and empower and guide the disciples. The rest of the book of Acts shows transformed people. The gift was real. The gift was there. And they never stopped anticipating that the Spirit was going to work in them. The same thing is true for us today. The same Spirit who lived in them is the same Spirit who lives in us. When we were baptized, the Holy Spirit entered into our hearts and transformed us. He removed all uncertainty about our salvation and assured us that we are saved through Jesus Christ. It brought us who have nothing to offer to the world to be able to speak the very words of God. It brought us who were timid and fearful to be brave and courageous followers of Jesus. The same Holy Spirit that lived in those disciples lives in us today. But I think sometimes why we struggle with wondering why and how the Spirit is working in our life is because we haven't stopped anticipating the Spirit working. We stop anticipating that God can actually use us for His purposes and His glory. We forget that we have the fruits of the Spirit, which are love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, gentleness, and self-control. But as we read Acts chapter 2, we are reminded that that same Spirit is the Spirit that lives in us. So this first night of our small group study for this year, as we look at Pentecost and see how the same Spirit that lives in disciples lives in us, I want you to consider a few questions. One, I want you to consider, are you anticipating the Spirit working in your life? And if no, why not? Two, I want you to consider how is your life reflecting the gifts of the Spirit? And finally, I want you to consider asking for God to give you an extra measure of the Holy Spirit. Because just as God transformed the lives of the disciples and used them to do marvelous and amazing things in their world and their time, God is calling you to do the same. So anticipate, live, and trust that the same Holy Spirit that was present at Pentecost is the Holy Spirit that's living in your heart. Please pray with me. God, we thank you that you give us a spirit of power and not timidity. We thank you that you have chosen to dwell in us and work through us. God, we pray today that you would give us an extra measure of your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we pray that we would anticipate you working through us in miraculous ways. Fill us with your fruits. Help our lives to reflect your love and your glory. Strengthen our faith and guide us as we serve you. In your name.